Flame Show, the NASCAR post-race overreaction show. This week we're going to talk about the, what was the name of the Camping World 500, but it's only 500 kilometers, not 500 miles, at Phoenix International Raceway, 312 miles. So right off the bat, what was your reaction to the race?
Well, my name is Rocco Shapiro.
Oh, I introduced us.
You're good. We can keep going.
We'll just roll with it.
Yeah, no, I mean, I was at work today, and I was able to watch the majority of the race on my phone, and at least more than 75% of the last half of the race. That makes sense.
More than three-quarters
of the
last half.
More than three-quarters of the last half.
Great. So you got to watch roughly...
I got roughly three-quarters of the last half.
17, 30 seconds of the race, right?
Yeah, no, I know, I did. But... If you want to give my final reactions of the last piece, that last caution totally put me on the edge of my seat, and literally, and then seeing what Newman did, and I guess I could spoil it. See what Newman did to hold off and win the race was so much fun. It
more
was
more importantly than what Newman did, and his name is Casey now, but what his crew chief did, Luke Lambert did with the call to leave him out. Three cars stayed on that last caution, I think, and. You know, a lot of times you see that strategy not work, especially at, got Ryan Blaney last year where he had the lead late on a restart. That's just the first one that comes to mind. But, they try things to get this track position, but it paid off. You know, it reminded me a lot of when Regan Smith won his Southern 500 over Carl Edwards after making a similar move. But how weird is that to see Ryan Newman? That's what struck me. I was sitting there watching on TV, and my brother's sitting over there. He's not even a NASCAR fan. He walked by and he goes, Is that Ryan Newman in victory lane? Like it's
123 races, something like that.
That's a long time. Yeah. It was 120 since RCR's last win.
Oh, maybe that's what the
and his last win was with Stuart Haas Racing,
at Phoenix. No,
it
was RCR's was last at Phoenix from Kevin Harvick.
And it's got to be close to 120 because if you're looking at 36 races a year, it's been 3.5 years.
Yeah, they would have brought up Newman's if it was at. It was
somewhere around there. Yeah, I know Newman's was at Phoenix. RCR's last one was at Phoenix with Kevin Harvick in the 29.
Yeah, that's alone is a crazy stat.
Yeah.
Their last one was from Kevin Harvick.
Yeah.
So that shows you how long they've been out. So, to wrap that up, I mean, crazy finish and amazing racing. Really fun to watch.
Yeah, I definitely thought it was good racing. Definitely a lot of headlines to talk about today. Obviously, Ryan Newman winning the race. The heat was a factor. Ryan Newman talked about his body overheating.
Right. How hot was it there?
Well, they had a thermometer inside Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car. At a point, it was just under 150 degrees Fahrenheit inside the car.
That's insane.
Which is absolutely ridiculous. Now, obviously, they have things that cool them off, but, I mean, still, 150 degrees is 150 degrees. One of the hottest races in since they've been recording the temperature at races in the Cup Series.
Mm.
And a lot of people were saying, Phoenix, they need to, run this race a different time of the year. This is actually only the second time Phoenix has had a race over 90 degrees in its entire history, so it really is just kind of a freak thing. Another headline was the Joey Logano versus Kyle Busch, the remnants from that from last week. Kind of uneventful this week. It's kind of funny, though, how it ended up. The caution that Joey Logano brought out by blowing a tire ended up costing Kyle Busch the race. Obviously, he didn't do it on purpose, but, kind of fun.
Well, hold on. Let's not pull out the conspiracy.
Oh, is this a conspiracy?
It could
Joey
be.
Logano threw his car into the wall.
What I think happened. Joey Logano did not throw away the race. Kyle Busch had someone slash a tire for Logano early, before the race started.
Oh,
and they were
ended
like,
up
okay,
back to
here's
get
what's going
to
happen. It's going to be a tire. We don't know what tire it is, but there's going to be a tire that's going to be a little soft. And that's what popped it. That's what did it. Obviously, that's not what happened at all, but...
I don't know. I believe it.
We can hold on to it. Yeah.
The last headline that I want to talk about today actually is a Saturday headline from the Xfinity race, and that's the crap that Austin Dillon pulled on Saturday.
That was tough to watch.
But we'll get into that after we go through the winners, the rundown, the race recap.
Okay.
So, right off the bat, all your winners from this weekend in the Monster Energy NASCAR Cup Series, the Camping World 500 kilometers... At Phoenix International Raceway, obviously Ryan Newman won. Great win for him. In the Xfinity Series, the DC Solar 200, also kilometers, I believe, at Phoenix International Raceway. Justin Allgaier won. He was a Dash for Cash driver this week, so it's nice to see an Xfinity regular win a race.
There were only Xfinity regulars in that race. Wasn't there a rule
Dillon
against
it?
Because it was the Dash for Cash, so doing something new
Austin
this year?
Austin Dillon was in it.
Yeah, but I think, is there like a rule that like... How do they get the Dash for Cash?
Because
I think
there
is a rule for the Dash for Cash 4 races or 3 races that they connect that they don't really have.
We'll
I think it's like if
that.
You've been racing for like 3 or something years. I don't know what it is.
That's a good call on that. Yeah. We'll come back to that.
Woo.
The K&N Pro Series West Tour opened up its season this last week. The East Tour opened up a couple weeks ago, but the West opened up this week at Tucson Speedway, the Napa Auto Parts Tucson 150. Chris Eggleston picked up the win, and the Whelen Modified Tour also opened up their season in the Performance Plus 150 presented by Safety Clean at Myrtle Beach Speedway. Timmy Solomito won the race. So,
I've been to Myrtle Beach Speedway. I haven't seen a race there.
Oh, yeah?
That's cool, yeah. So that's where they open up their season?
Yeah, from what I gathered, this, I haven't really kept up with the Modified Tour in 2 or 3 years, but this was, I'm pretty sure it was the first, I don't know, if, well, I guess what I'm saying, I know it was their season opener, I don't know if it's regularly their season opener.
Oh, okay.
I think it is, though.
I gotcha.
I think they keep a pretty consistent schedule, but yeah, good for Timmy Solomito, Chris Eggleston, Justin Allgaier, and Ryan Newman, then obviously a lot of winners in the regional series, stuff like that, but too many to go over.
Well, at least you highlight the little guys.
Yeah, I do what I can.
Yeah,
I do what I can.
It's good.
But obviously, we're here to talk about the big leagues,
the big boys.
Yeah, the Cup Monster Series. Cup so let's series. Let's give us a race rundown.
Oh, we're giving a rundown. Let's All right, give a let's race go into rundown. It. This is my favorite part of the show. All right, we're gonna start off me with the odd numbers and Britt over here with the even numbers, as we do every week. There were 39 contenders in today's race. Not. Is that the abnormal? Was last week 39 also?
39. I don't know about Vegas. I know Atlanta was 39.
39
technically,
was
NASCAR says 36 is a full race with 4 open spots. So,
all right.
Not. It kind of bums me out to see 39 when that means there's a spot that could have been there. And that also means, you know, we were at 43 a couple years ago. But either way, 39 guys in the
anyway,
race.
Anyway, regardless.
So let's hit the rundown.
All right, let's get it. Starting in number... Oh, wow, I already fucked up.
Oh, you won't.
That's okay.
Yeah,
that's all right. Now let's restart. starting in the 39...
You did it again.
I did it again.
You
finishing,
know what? He might have started 39th.
He started 38th. Starting in the 38th position, finishing 39th is our good friend Jeffrey Earnhardt. He had a transmission issue on lap 9 and did not recover.
In 38th place was Corey LaJoie. He had an incident today. Interesting thing there with Reed Sorensen. We'll get to that in a second.
Ooh. Finishing 37th was Matt Kenseth. He had a hard hit, somehow even harder than Harvick's from last week.
Yeah, I'd like to see the crash data on that.
Yeah.
In 36th place was Greg Golding. He had a run-in with the 35th place finisher.
35th place finisher was David Reagan. David Reagan blew a left rear and collided with Golding.
That's true. In 34th place was Cole Witt. Cole Witt blew a tire, I think. I know he got into the wall. I don't remember what caused it. I assume it was a tire because a lot of guys had tire issues this week.
Yep, and 36th... Did I get that? 33. Jeez. 33. I guess I'm reading wrong numbers. In 33rd was Derek Cope. He, ripe age of 58, continuing the race. Said, you know, don't have a lot. Let's continue.
In 32nd was the 51 car of Timmy Hill. This is his highest finish of the season out of 2 races that he's participated.
Yes.
I believe his finishes are 32nd and 37th.
All right. And in 31st was Joey Logano. One segment one, slowly faded, blew a tire.
In 30th place was Reed Sorensen. Going back to the Corey LaJoie incident, a lot of people were saying that Reed Sorensen intentionally wrecked Corey LaJoie because Corey LaJoie wrecked him to make the Daytona 500. So interesting interesting little theory there going on with those two.
There we are. Number finishing 29th was Matt DiBenedetto. Solid race. We're expecting big things this year.
In 28th place was Landon Castle. He actually had a pretty decent run going. I think he had a pit road penalty or some kind of issue on pit road. Still ended up 28th, which, you know, not bad for one of those lower teams.
27th was Chris Buescher. We're still waiting for him and the other JTG teammate to pick it up.
In 26th place, which was the other JTG car in the 47 AJ Allmendinger. I'm really hoping the JTG picks it up a little bit. 26th and 27th is a little bit below my expectations.
They have 2 cars. No, you know, no reason, no excuses.
Yeah,
no
yeah.
excuses. All right. 25th was Kurt Busch. Another battery issues again.
Yeah, the battery things are kind of starting to get, they're getting kind of weird.
Mm-hmm.
In the 24th place, Michael McDowell. He and AJ Allmendinger had a real good little battle there. I thought they were going to wreck each other, but that was fun to watch.
Right. And 23rd was the 21 car of Ryan Blaney. He sat on the outside pole, had pit road penalty, and seriously, he never recovered.
Yeah, it was disappointing to see. In 22nd was Phoenix native Danica Patrick.
Ooh. In 21st was Paul Menard.
In 20th was the number 5 car of Casey Kane. Well, I thought we were going to get some comments from the peanut.
Casey Kane! I said Casey Kane! Well, we were expecting...
Anyway, he had some kind of pit road issue. I'm not really sure what it was, but I know he had a pit road issue.
All right, and in 19th...
Casey Kane! No!
And in 19, he drives like a goat. In Casey Kane. No, stop it. In 19th, we had Trevor Brain.
All aboard the Kane train, boy.
He was loose all day. Every time he showed him, he was slip sliding around the track.
In 18th is one of my new least favorite drivers based on the Xfinity Series mess. Was Austin Dillon, who I also want to call out. Well, I'll get to that in a second.
Oh, you want to call him out?
Oh, I'm going to call him out.
Okay. In 17th, we had Eric Almirola. You know, the funny thing about this kid, his name starts with an A instead of an E. It's like, you know,
that's pick one. It's like Arik, you know?
Yeah, it's like, yeah, it should be Arik, you know, regardless.
In 16th place, the other Dillon, Ty Dillon, and this is what I want to call out Austin for. He's finished behind his brother 2 weeks in a row in much better equipment. who's really the better Dillon is what I want to ask.
Who's the better Dillon? That's a hand rub. is that an expression?
No.
Is that even an expression?
It is now. Okay. That's a hand rubber.
I feel like it's a euphemism. All right.
For masturbation. That's what you were getting at, right?
That's not quite what I was getting at.
In 15th place.
Okay, that's a great segue. Into 15th place, we have Jamie McMurray. Actually, he had a really good run. I don't know. Can we just go to 14th?
In 14th place, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Disappointing, never had it all day. And I believe that was the same car that Alex Bowman just about won the race in last year. So step it up, Jr.
Yeah, really. It's a disappointing season so far.
Yeah. He'll get there,
yeah, finishing 13th was Clint Boyer. Not disappointing. Definitely under the radar all day today.
12th place was Chase Elliott. Excuse me. He started pretty high. Kind of, he won segment two, didn't he?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Chase Elliott won segment two. That was Chevrolet's first segment win of the year. Crazy.
All right. And in 11th is Martin Truex, the Truflex, the Suplex, the Truex, the Martin Truex, the Truflex, Suplex Jr. finishing 11th. He got stuck on an air hose.
Yeah, that was really goofy. It was actually hilarious. Yeah. Check out that video. We're going to try to post it if we're allowed to. I don't know if we are.
Probably not.
In 10th place was Denny Hamlin. I don't know. He had two tires go down this weekend. One in qualifying, made him start from the back. One during the race today. He had to go back in a late caution. Still ended up finishing 10th. Good for him.
In 9th was Jimmy Johnson. I don't even know if this is true. This is his first top 10 of the season.
Yeah,
that is a crazy thing to say.
First, and it was only 9th.
Let's talk about somebody who's under the radar. He's been there all season.
But every time they talk about Jimmy Johnson being on the radar,
oh God,
he
please.
Won the championship.
Oh God.
So. In 8th place, great run for Eric Jones. They've been talking a lot about his pit road issues. Not his pit road issues, the team's pit road issues the last couple weeks. They said they got it ironed out this week, and it showed because he finished 8th, so good for him.
Yeah, well, another great rookie here. Finishing 7th was Daniel Suarez. This is the year of the underdogs. Just leave it at that.
Yeah, I'm really glad to see Daniel Suarez finishing well. In 6th place is the dude at Phoenix, Kevin Harvick. This broke a 3-race winning streak in the spring Phoenix race. He's also won 6 out of the last 9 races there and 8 races overall. Yes, I pulled all those stats from my head. So 6th place, although it seems disappointing since he normally wins, he was nowhere all day and then came out of nowhere and finished 6th. So good for him.
Well, someone who came out of nowhere and pretty fell off the map was Brad Keselowski finishing 5th. Reason why I say that is he failed post-race inspection.
He did. Jeff Gluck said that he failed post-race inspection for measurements and weights. Kind of a vague description there. We'll get more on that as it develops. In 4th place, Ricky Stenhouse Jr., great run for him. Been waiting for him to pick it up. The whole Roush organization, well, now just the two cars, but Ricky Stenhouse Jr. specifically too. Really great to see him finish 4th.
Would you say he got in the way of the 3rd place finishing Kyle Busch?
I wouldn't say he got in the way, but I would say that he definitely affected the race for 2nd place finisher Kyle Larson when Kyle Larson really could have won the race on the last restart but ended up coming down on the 17 car. His spotter actually cleared him, said he was clear inside when he came down, came across the nose of the 17 and didn't spin out. Great save for Kyle Larson, ended up finishing 2nd. He could have won that race, but he didn't. Who did?
Hello, Newman. Finishing 1st is Ryan Newman, breaking the RCR winless streak of 123 races and him 378 races. That's not true, but he has not won in a long time. Your face is great.
Matt doesn't quite end up there.
He hasn't won a race since 2007.
July or August 2007. It was the Brickyard 400.
2013 was.
That's what I meant. 2013. Yeah. So it's been a long time for him. And it was a long time before he won that race, too, because it wasn't his only win, it was SHR.
No, because he won at Phoenix.
He did win at Phoenix, and he won at Martinsville that race that Jeff Gordon should have won.
Oh, yeah, that's forgettable. That was a good
Not
race.
Not for me. But we'll get into that at some other time.
So
yeah, great win for Ryan Newman. Great call by Luke Lambert. I really hope that's his name. I think his name is Luke Lambert. But great call by Luke Lambert to leave him out. Him, Stenhouse, and who was the other car that stayed out on that last restart?
McMurray?
I think it was McMurray.
Which... Oh, no, Kurt Busch. Kurt Busch didn't take it. He went down pit road, but didn't take any tires.
He got blocked. He was about to dive into his pit box, got blocked by his brother, and then went off pit road. And he would have won the race off pit road, but then got stopped by another car, ended up coming off pit road like fourth, throwing the cars that stayed out. He ended up restarting like seventh or eighth. So
Kind
of disappointing. Well,
then it might have been McMurray.
I think it was McMurray. And I feel bad for McMurray. Shout out to... Chip Ganassi Racing, though, because McMurray had a great run all day.
Yeah, definitely.
Restarted third on that final restart. Kyle Larson restarted fourth.
Yeah, and Larson looked to be one of the favorites second. Towards the end.
Interesting little fact about Larson, and again, I'm pulling this from my head, so I'm not 100% sure. First of all, he has lost the lead. He has had the lead with less than 10 laps to go and lost it in Homestead last year, Daytona this year, and Atlanta this year, so that was three consecutive races. He had the lead with less than 10 to go and lost it. He also, since his win at Michigan last year, which was in August?
Yeah,
it was before the chase, but it was the second Michigan race. This is absolutely crazy. They mentioned this today during the race, then you add another one. I hardly even believe it, so I really do want to fact check it. But since his win in August of last year, he has finished second 5 times.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. 5 times
out of what? Does nearly fit 20 races, maybe?
Not even. I mean, you had the 10 for the play, for the chase last
and now
year.
We're 3 in.
3 so far this year, so 13. So
15, maybe 15.
15, 17 races even, he's finished second.
Even if we call it 15, times. One of 3 races, you know.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
That's 5 times he's finished second, which, you know, today was one of them. Atlanta, he ended up second. I think he ended up second at Homestead when Jimmy Johnson won after the whole fiasco in that last restart. So there's 3 of them right there. But while it sucks that he's finishing second, and you could really see the emotion in his post-race interview, he was really disappointed that he couldn't make... Well, he made the right move. He was really disappointed that when he made the move, Stenhouse was there. Because he said if he had just stayed up, he'd feel like he could have made it, or if Stenhouse hadn't have been there. Yeah. Obviously, he's not mad about it. Just he's disappointed in the fact that he didn't win the race in a race that he could have won. That being said, if you finish second 5 times in 15 or 17 races, you're going to get a win eventually. Especially now that it looks like the whole team is stepping up because McMurray, like we said, was running third on that final restart. Something happened to that car. Flat tire, maybe an engine issue. I don't know what happened. Something happened and he ended up finishing 15th, I think. But Chip Ganassi Racing is definitely stepping up, and that's good to see because they have talented drivers and they deserve to, you know, especially with a young gun like Kyle Larson, who really is one of the futures of the sport. It's good to see him have those good runs, someone that people can grasp onto. He's leading the points right now for the first time
that
in his
is
career.
True. That is true.
He seemed to be really excited about
that.
I wonder what
the last time, I know now we're pulling out list of, you know, shopping list of things that we need to fact check, but I wonder when the last time a Ganassi driver had the points lead.
Wow. You
know
what? I bet it was when
McMurray
won
the 500. Yeah.
Wow.
And some people forget about McMurray. In 2010, he dominated.
He had a big year.
He had a huge year.
He won the 500, mm-hmm. the Brickyard 400, which at the time, that was still a huge marquee race. I mean, it's on the most famous racetrack in the world. Well, I think Daytona is, but debatable.
Yeah. He won the second Charlotte race.
The second Charlotte race. And didn't he have another one? Oh, did
Southern
he win the
500?
All, he didn't. Maybe he won the All-Star race that year. Ooh, he's won the All-Star race fairly recently. But yeah, McMurray's nothing to sneeze at. He won his second ever start. For Ganassi, strangely enough, before he left for Roush in the 40 car. So, I mean, McMurray's a good driver. You know, he's I don't want to say he's underrated, but I really do think he's underrated. And now that Chip Ganassi's tempered their equipment, it wouldn't surprise me to see him pull off a Ryan Newman-esque victory.
I hope so. I like how competitive the season's been so far.
Oh, yeah. We've seen wins from 4 different drivers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on the one hand, Keselowski really should have won 2 in a row. Because his issue at Vegas, he should have won that race. But at the same time, he should have won Atlanta, if you want to look at it that
way. Well, I mean, you want to talk about 2 weeks in a row where the best driver didn't win the race.
I would say every single week so far, the best driver didn't win the race. Because if you look at Daytona, the best driver...
Well, there's no such thing.
You say the fastest car, which would have been Chase
or Junior,
who both ran. No one saw Kurt Busch coming. Kurt Busch is He's definitely a good driver, but I think that was his first ever restrictor plate,
mm-hmm.
or whatever you want to call it, super speedway win.
Yeah.
Which is crazy. He's been in the sport since... I think his first start was...
2002?
He was a rookie in 2001, but I think he made a start in 99 and 2000.
Okay.
Either way, absolutely ridiculous that this is his first restrictor plate win. You know, he does 4 races a year, but obviously won the favorite Daytona. Atlanta, Kevin Harvick absolutely dominated that race. Keselowski ended up winning it, which unexpected, but it was the pit road penalty on Kevin Harvick. Vegas, that one's, again, debatable because I think Truex had the best car all day, but then Keselowski took over the title of best car. And then obviously today, today we actually saw a lot of different people lead. There really wasn't one person out of
grasp. Yeah, there wasn't a huge standout. It wasn't like the other years we previously talked about Kevin Harvick dominating, where he was clearly the best car and the for sure winner.
Either way, no one saw Newman coming.
Oh, no, absolutely
no,
not.
I didn't see it. Even when they said three cars stayed out when they on that last restart, I still didn't think
they were
going
to be in the way. Because so many times we've seen with two to go or three to go, you know, five to go, with people stay out. And they just get run over. Mm-hmm. And it's some type of old school racing that Newman was able to hold that together.
Yeah, Newman, he's a veteran. Of course. I trust him on old tires more than I trust a lot of other guys going into the turn one at Phoenix. Phoenix is just, it's a good track for him. It's a good track for old tire. It doesn't, as old as the surface is, it doesn't really chew up tires like a place like Atlanta does.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why, like Larson, who took two tires, that strategy ended up working for him. A lot of the guys took two tires. That could have also played into how he held them off because it was no tires versus two rather than no tires versus four. But yeah, and a lot of it also had to do, I think, with the way the restart went down. Mm-hmm. Stenhouse had an issue, which stopped the inside lane. The only threat would have been from Larson at that point, who then hit Stenhouse. So it kind of, it didn't give him the win, but it set it up real nicely for him. But I mean, either way, he had to lead those last two laps. So.
Let me ask you a question real quick. Mm-hmm. And so far we've had four races, correct? Yeah, four races. Mm-hmm. And they've all been, I feel, strangely entertaining to watch, even the middle of the race or the beginning of the race or whenever, parts that might lull you a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Does that have effect, or is that affected by the segments or the low downforce package that really have changed?
That's actually
on these mile and a mile and a half tracks, and even in Daytona, of course.
Right. No, and that's a really good question, because that's a question everyone's asked, because there was a lot of changes over the off season as far as the rules go. So what is to it? I think it's a combination of both.
Mm-hmm.
Having been to a race this year and having watched all of them so far this year, I can say that the segments, I was not a fan when they first announced it. They're starting to grow on me. One of the things, and actually in my notes for the show today, we can go ahead and get into that now, is the finish at segment one. I guess you weren't able to see that.
I did not see that.
It ended up being really, really wild. It wasn't a photo finish or anything, but Logano had pretty much led the whole segment. And then at the last second, he caught some lap traffic, and Chase Elliott caught right up to him. And whoever was in second at the time, it might have been the two car. I don't remember. It wasn't Keselowski because I know one's teammate. But either way, it was the 22 and the 24 was up there. The one car was running fourth, and they crossed the line.
I think I might have saw a clip of this then.
Yeah, they came across the line like bang, 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 like 1, 2, 3, 4. It ended up being a really good finish, and that was just the end of segment one. So I do think the segments add to it. It also adds those, I didn't think it was going to feel like natural brakes, but the way that NASCAR threw cautions for phantom debris and stuff like that before the segments, I feel like the cautions are going to come anyway. It adds a new element of strategy. So I do think that has a lot to do with it. But at the same time, you look at the last segment was more than, I think they want to call them stages, by the way.
Stages.
Either way, last stage was more than 50% of the race. So if we pretend like there weren't stages and that it was just natural cautions, the racing was still really, really good in the last stage. I think that a lot of it does have to do with the low downforce package, because even though it's hard to see while watching, I'm sure the drivers can feel it better than we can see it, but it just makes everything, the main thing is the leader used to have such a huge advantage over everyone else because of the clean air on the car, because they were so aerodynamically dependent that if you had the least disturbed air on your car, you had a big advantage. So once someone got the lead, it was hard to take it from them. Or really any position. Once you caught up to someone, because the issue is once you catch up to someone, the air from the turbulence from their car is messing up your car so much you can't pass. So passing was harder. Now with lower downforce, not only does it make the cars harder to drive because they're not sucking down to the track as much, they're also just overall less dependent on the air. So you can catch someone and your car still handles pretty well. Right. Like, you don't lose as much handling when you ride on someone's bumper. So we've seen a lot better racing, a lot more slipping and sliding. So to answer your question, I do think it's been a combination of both, but I really do think the low downforce package has the most to do with it. You know, a race like today where there was no single, like we talked about, there was no single car that dominated the race.
Yeah, yeah.
Which was awesome. You know, it was awesome to see a few different guys get up there, and then someone from out of nowhere ended up winning it. Yeah. So
what's next? Good.
Well, I wanted to talk about the whole top 10, actually. Very, very,
very
solid top 10.
Very,
because we had guys like
strange even so.
Yeah, because we had guys like Newman, Stenhouse, Suarez was in it. Eric Jones. So that's 4 out of 10 right there. Kyle Larson was in it. I mean, he's definitely turning into one of the bigger name drivers, but still.
And even I highlighted on the rundown, and this is Jimmy Johnson's first top 10 of the season.
Right, right. So
it's crazy. Even for the veterans, it's a little crazy.
Yeah. It was, and that just shows how competitive it's getting. And I think this goes back to the low downforce. You just, you know, you don't know where it's going to come from. You don't know where the wind's going to come from. And also, there were a lot of pit road issues that led to the field being shuffled and stuff like that. But I mean, there wasn't. It's not like a Daytona where there's a big crazy wreck and some guy caught a draft and ended up finishing 8th or something like that. You know, Suarez, he earned that 7th place finish. No one can say he didn't. At a very difficult track too. So Suarez, Eric Jones, Stenhouse Jr.,
and even Hamlin coming back from having a tough
race.
Yeah,
from having a tire issue. So that was good to see. You know, I really like the parody of it. I like seeing all the different guys in the top 10. Another guy in the top 10, Kyle Busch. He, I don't know if you've been seeing this week, but...
All right, was it about the interview?
Yeah. You saw the interview.
I saw this interview.
Did you see the first one that he had at practice?
Yes, it was the first day of practice.
So I heard an audio clip of it before I saw the video from Jeff Gluck, who, by the way, is the man.
The goat.
The goat.
The actual goat.
He's not actually a goat.
He's the actual goat.
I don't know if I've ever seen him.
I've seen a picture of him. He's the actual the goat.
Okay.
There you go.
But anyway, I heard an audio clip that he had recorded, and I honestly, for a second, thought that someone had dubbed Kyle Busch's first answer over for every single question.
Nope, that's
how
he
consistent
did.
He was on the Everything's Great. And then he answered, Jamie Little asked him a question yesterday, a very legitimate question, and he started off his answer with Everything's Great. And then today in the post-race interview, he said the same thing. Pre-race interview, too, he said Everything's Great. I think...
What's the play there? Like,
I
want to
say it's 11 times... He said everything's great, and it's so consistent.
Is there some like subtext there? Like,
well,
like you think he's just blowing it off? It's like, come on, let's just get to the racing. We have a good car this week.
I think that's really it. I'd be willing to bet that either his PR guy or someone from NASCAR or something
might have been his sponsors too. Have a bit of play.
That's true. Eminem said they weren't happy about the way he treated the situation last week.
Yeah.
It could
have a play, and then that trickles down to the PR guy, and he's like,
right, you know, we gotta keep the sponsors.
This
happy.
Is a good sponsor. We have to, you know.
Right now, and I don't think Eminem would drop sponsorship over something like that. But you definitely do want to keep.
But
the
I mean,
happy.
No, you don't want to have that happen again.
But yeah, I think it's just a matter of. A lot of times, you know, when people, you see the drivers all the time, Kevin Harvick's done it, where they get in a fight one week, and the next week the reporters are asking them over and over and over about it, and they just don't want to talk about it, because it's over, it's a non-story, and I don't know if I talked to you about this, or if, I don't remember who I was talking to about this, but the fight was on Sunday, and it's 2017, so I'm 100% sure that Joey Logano and Kyle Busch talked about it since then.
Well, they said they did, not they said they did, but...
They had a meeting, right?
Well, they had to have a meeting. Yeah, they had a meeting.
Well, right, and I know they had to have a meeting, but I mean, there had to be so many times, and I guess it's not a great example because I forgot that they did say that they had a meeting. But
and then they shot a text in between each other,
right?
Like on
exactly.
Tuesday or
you know,
Wednesday.
And the thing is, obviously there was a fist fight, but I mean, in the heat of the moment, things. I've punched you in the face before. Like
it's a workplace accident.
Yeah,
you know?
it just happens. It honestly just happens. And obviously, you know, if they're not friends, if they still don't like each other, I get it. Even if Kyle Busch is still mad about it, you can't say that he's as mad as he was last Sunday. So the fact that they still immediately, and he knew it was coming, and that's where I think it comes from. I think he planned the Everything's Great thing, because he knew as soon as he got to the track, they were going to start asking about the Logano incident. So he's just going to hit him with the Everything's Great, kind of like the Marshawn Lynch.
Marshawn Lynch, yeah, the Seahawks.
I'm just here so I don't get fined. They mentioned the parallel today about how Marshawn Lynch eats the Skittles, and today Kyle Busch had the Skittles car. So kind of a funny little parallel.
Nice callback.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I don't know. It cracked me up.
It was funny. I sent it to my dad because he was very passionate about the incident last week.
Yeah.
And I sent it to him. He's like, yeah, it's a good laugh. He's a bit of a dick, but he played it off.
He kind of played
the character there at that point. You know, he could have gave a straightforward answer, and one answer would have covered all of them. But one answer did cover all of them.
Yeah, that's true. He made.
But you know, he kind of played the dick character in that moment.
So. I didn't mean to stall out here because I was reading my notes. But speaking of speaking of Kyle Busch and the Joey Logano incident, I was very anxiously awaiting, because even though I said I'm sure they've calmed down since then, Kyle Busch is a very stubborn, hot-headed guy. Nothing wrong with that. Very competitive. I was when the first time Kyle Busch caught Joey Logano.
Oh, did that so happen excited. During the race?
Yeah, it was in segment two, I think, because Logano won segment one. It was early in segment two. Logano was slipping back. Kyle Busch is moving forward. I was so excited. Here they come. Absolutely not. Kyle Busch passed him. No big deal.
No big deal.
I'm sure part of it was and
too early in the race. You know,
it's too early in the race.
Kind of the situation.
Kyle Busch obviously had a really good car. Could have won the race, so he didn't want to mess that up for himself, which is good. I don't know if the spotter was saying don't touch anything. I'd be willing to bet that it's just a matter of it's not worth getting revenge for last week and cautioning yourself this week too.
Right.
Because the fact of the matter is, Kyle Busch finished like 22nd last week. Yeah. And he needed a good finish, and he got it this week. So
and he have enough. He hasn't had a top.
Yeah, 10 I was gonna. Say, that's a good call.
Was he the other driver?
I think that he's one of the other guys. This is his first top 10. Obviously, he was running third last week. So, but yeah, he needed a good finish. So there's no reason to mess it up in segment two. Another interesting battle we touched on earlier. Was it AJ Allmendinger versus Michael McDowell?
That looked like it was going to be shaping into something really strange because it was a battle for what, 26th, 28th?
It was back there.
Yeah. And it was crazy because obviously the commentators played it up really well.
Right.
They played up like, you know, there's a battle everywhere you look. The track's got a lot of cars. We're doing a lot of laps here. But they really played it well and. I was surprised because Dinger, you want to talk about somebody who's very hot-headed in the very competitive sense. I thought that might have been the caution. That was like, oh, this could be the caution. This could be the caution that sends us into the end.
Yeah, you look at something like Michael McDowell, who's a guy who fights for every position every week because he has to. And you look at a guy like AJ Allmendinger, who's probably frustrated running 27th. Plus, he's a very emotional guy. I was really thinking, I was looking for big things to happen. And obviously nothing came out of it as far as a wreck goes, but we saw some good racing out of it.
That's not disappointing, though. Yeah. I mean, it's not disappointing that we didn't see a wreck. It was good camera time for those guys and the Levine Family Racing and JTG, respectively.
Yeah.
But it is funny that they just show this battle towards the end. And, I mean, it's funny to see how far the sport's gone that's allowed to happen, you know?
Yeah.
That there's a huge battle back in 28th
and then
this low downforce, whatever it would be in that situation. Mm-hmm. And it was really cool that two somewhat classy guys can battle it out back there.
Right.
Cleanly.
So someone who battled it out not so cleanly,
ooh,
taking it away from the cup race, and this bothered me so much, was what Austin Dillon did on Saturday to Cole Custer. And the main reason that it bothered me so much, and we talked about this last week in the fight, after the fight, you just don't use the car. You know, settle it off the track. There are two things that bothered me about this. There were a lot of things, but I'm going to call out three or four here. One, it was an accident. Cole Custer, it was so obviously an accident. And it wasn't an accident based on, like, he was being reckless. He just got loose. Okay.
Because Austin Dillon's standpoint was that Cole Custer overdrove the turn, whatever it was. I think he overdrove the turn,
but I don't think he overdrove the turn trying to get into someone or trying to make a move. I think he overdrove the turn because it's
just a mistake.
It's his third race or fourth race ever in an Xfinity Series car.
And Phoenix is crazy, too.
And Phoenix is a crazy hard track.
And an insanely hard track. And imagine diving underneath somebody like that.
Right.
Could be frustrating.
And then you can't blame Austin Dillon for being upset. That would upset me, too, because he had nothing to do with it and got taken out. But come on. You cannot tell me the Cole Custer did that on purpose.
Yeah, it
another thing that bothered me about it is, even though I said he has the right to be upset, does he really? It's an Xfinity race. He's a cup driver.
That's not his
thing. He needs to move on.
Yeah, that's not his thing. It's like,
be upset about it.
He was one of one of two or three drivers from the cup that were gonna race in the cup race the next day.
Right.
You know, and we talked about the Dash for Cash thing. It's those Busch, those Xfinity guys battling out. That's what they made that event for.
Right. And this
four times a year. Let them have it. Cole Custer wrecks you. You get angry. You want to be classy. You want to be a cup driver. Talk it out at the end of the race. Talk it out when you're ready.
Or, you know, honestly, if you get wrecked, if you're Kyle Busch, who obviously I don't think was in this race, this is one of the ones that he couldn't be in. But in the Xfinity season, if you're Kyle Busch, if you're Austin Dillon, if you're Joey Logano, if you're Brad Keselowski, even I'm as much as I like him, if you're Ryan Blaney at this point, if something happens, you're not running for points. You're not running for a ride. You're not running for any of these things that these other guys are running for. So if something happens, let it go. But Austin Dillon had to go out and then mess up Cole Custer's, who still could have had a potential for a good run, damage his car. You know what I mean? And that got under my skin so much.
Because it's one thing if they both wreck out and then you use your car as a battling ram. Because we've seen that before. And that's just like, they were both out anyway. But it's just, it's it's not an eye for an eye situation.
Yeah.
It's not, you wreck me, now I'm going to come wreck you right now. You know, right after that.
And
you know?
And in Austin Dillon's defense, I don't know if he was trying to wreck Cole Custer. A good parallel to this, my favorite driver of all time, Jeff Gordon, when he had his incident in Phoenix with...
Clint Bowyer.
With Clint Bowyer. He said that he wasn't trying to wreck him. He was just trying to get in his way and turn into a wreck. But they talked to Jeff Gordon about that today in the pre-race. And he said that he wishes he could take that back. Because Jeff Gordon, who ended up winning the next week at Homestead, his only win at Homestead, he said, I should not have been in that race. I should have been parked. So that shows you how he feels about it.
Right.
And honestly, as happy as I am that he won that race and that he got to keep his consecutive start streak going, all that stuff too, you don't use the car as a weapon. I don't like that, especially if the guy is still in contention. And Cole Custer, I don't know what place he was in. I wasn't watching the race. I just saw the highlights. I don't know what place he was in when it happened, but Austin Dillon took another guy's chances out in a wrecked car. He used the car as a weapon. It's dangerous. It's, you know, like, he shouldn't care. It's going to hurt Cole Custer, who is running for Xfinity points. There's just so many things I don't like about it. And then top it all off, Cole Custer on Twitter said, I made a mistake today and cost me and Austin Dillon a chance at a good finish. Totally took the blame for it. Very cool thing to say, right?
Right.
And Austin Dillon's reply was, thanks for that, and a thumbs up emoji. Ugh. Which to me is like...
total dick undertone.
Exact. I don't think that Austin Dillon was trying to be a dick when he said, but why didn't Austin Dillon say what he should have done? And I think if it was Matt Kenseth, or if it was, you know, Joey Logano, or maybe not Logano, but if it was, you know, a veteran guy, a respectable driver, he would have said... you know, I shouldn't have done what I did. Or something like, the fact that Cole Custer said it was his fault.
It goes on both ends.
Exactly. Yeah. Why didn't Austin Dillon say, like, oh, you know, like, sorry I ran you so hard. Or sorry,
yeah,
I wrecked
your
car.
You know, it's not a video game out there. You're not just wrecking Cole Custer. You're wrecking the whole team that travels out there.
Right, right.
You're wrecking the shop back in North Carolina.
Yeah.
And it's not you and him out there. It's just not two people. And it's funny because you say that with your... favorite driver of all time, being Jeff Gordon. I could say my favorite driver of all time being Tony Stewart, who has done those crazy shits, as Austin Dillon has at a young age, of course. You can't necessarily blame Austin Dillon entirely. He is young still. But if he wants to act older, you got to toughen up, talk to him after the race, do what somebody else would have done, you know?
Right. Yeah, and there's no reason.
And it's done in the past. There's no reason, and I have nowhere to come from because Tony Stewart's done it hundreds of times.
Yeah.
But you just don't do that. Like, plain and simple, you want to hit him after the race.
Right. No,
you know, hit his car after the race. Do something afterwards.
And the only... okay. Well, I shouldn't even say this.
Let him know you're there.
But the only time I've ever liked it, and this is a special exception, because just in case this comes up, I want to defend myself. During the race at Sonoma, I don't know when it was, but Tony Stewart... straight up wrecked Brian Vickers. And then Brian Vickers straight up wrecked Tony
Sonoma?
Stewart out of lead. Yeah.
Yeah.
But the reason I was okay with that one, not okay with it. I don't like anyone wrecking anyone on purpose. But the fact of the matter is, Tony Stewart did wreck Brian Vickers on purpose, and he said he did.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said, I would have done the same thing and wrecking me back.
Yeah.
So at least that one, they still kind of settle it like adults. But I mean, when you see something like...
it's a weird line because it's nearly the same thing.
They still...
But they savor the moment.
The difference is, it wouldn't bother me as much, and this is what bothered me about Austin Dillon's and about Jeff Gordon's at Phoenix. The difference is Cole Custer didn't do it on purpose, and Clint Bowyer didn't do what he did on purpose. I mean, it's one thing if it's hard racing and it leads to an incident, because you can be mad at the guy, but you don't wreck him. Cole Custer, that wasn't even hard racing. He just made a mistake.
Yeah.
So that's what bothers me the most about it. You know, in a situation like the Tony Stewart one at Sonoma, at least he wrecked a guy on purpose, got wrecked on purpose. There's a little justice there. You know, whatever. I can live with that. I don't like using the cars, but I can live with that. You know, something like, I can't think of another example off the top of my head, but if you wreck a guy on purpose and get wrecked, you had it coming.
Here's the best way to handle it. We'll end it after this.
The
best way to show you're assertive, that you can't be pushed around, the best way to handle that situation if you are Austin Dillon is just give him a tap, let him know you're there. You're racing every other, you're racing every week. Just let him know you're watching.
Right.
He'll be back on the back of his neck the entire season. Just let him know you're there.
He'll
be thinking about it. They're both young guys. Cole Custer being a lot younger. How old is he? 20 maybe.
If that.
18, 19.
Yeah.
He'll be thinking about it.
Yeah, and
he'll be thinking about
or even a good old fashioned helmet throw or something like that.
Yeah, just something. Let him think about it.
Something,
you know,
like that. But you don't wreck it.
You know, you blow your load early. You know, save it for the rest of the season.
But we'll see what happens on Tuesday, because I definitely think, because a lot of the fallout from the Joey Logano Kyle Busch fight was they were talking about, oh, there's no penalties, but they were saying that's because it went down on pit road. Don't use the car as a weapon. And then Austin Dillon does that. I'm really interested to see the penalty that comes on Tuesday. Because I think there's definitely going to be one for him.
Okay, you think so?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would like to see him not allowed to drive any Xfinity races, but I think he has less than 5 years experience in the Cup Series. Therefore, he can run all the Xfinity races, and he might be scheduled to run a lot of them. So maybe it wouldn't be a good idea to ban him from all of them, but at least sit him for the next one he's scheduled for or something. You can't.
I would say so. I think that's the best thing for the Xfinity. Just calm him down. That's not their race.
Yeah. I believe that's pretty much all we have to say about the Camping World 500. Ryan Newman won, very interesting top 10. Kyle Larson's second place streak. Kyle wishes everything's great. Segment one finish. The hard hit by Kenseth. I don't know if we talked about that too much. Kenseth did take. I mean, I know we mentioned it. That was a wicked hit. So glad to see that he's okay.
Yeah, definitely violent after a few replays.
It was a bad angle.
It's hard to see.
I've thought about it. I don't know if it's harder than Harvick's, because Harvick was going a lot faster. The reason it looked harder is because of the angle he hit,
which
made the damage
right
differently.
Off the turn, yeah.
Yeah, Harvick hit so square that it didn't even tear up the car that much, visibly. Harvick was going, had to be going 190 miles an hour when he hit.
Yeah, at least 180, yeah.
But it was a better angle for him.
Kenseth bounced off the wall and nearly went down pit road. That's how hard he hit.
Kenseth was a ridiculous.
So I don't know, it's debatable. Is there like a decibel system or something that they determine?
They measure the G-forces of the hits.
Do they?
But
do NASCAR, they release those?
NASCAR
they
doesn't release the data. They release. They might say which one was harder, but they
somebody
won't give
might,
numbers.
Somebody might, if somebody asks the question, somebody might release
yeah,
it.
They might say which one's harder, but they won't release the numbers. They might not even bring it up, though, because I don't know if anyone's going to think about it as much as we do. But,
that's right. Maybe we'll ask the tough, hard-hitting questions. Hard-hitting questions? Goodness. All right.
Anyway, let's move on to next week. So
we're still hanging out in the West, huh?
Yeah, this is the last week of the hashtag NASCAR Goes West campaign.
Woohoo.
Actually, is well, never mind.
Okay.
But yeah, Fontana. So, what are you thinking for Fontana?
Ooh, Fontana is.
It's had some of the best racing the last few
years.
It
really has, and before then, I think that one used to be a snoozer race.
Oh yeah,
California has been a snoozer race for a while. But these, I don't know what it was since these Gen 6 cars. I want to say maybe 2011. They've really picked up.
It has gotten really good. I'm really excited for the low downforce, because low downforce means less grip in the turns, which means they're going to be slipping and sliding a lot more. Better racing in the turns. But it also means faster speeds down the straightaway. So not only are they going to be going into the turn with less downforce, they're going to be going into the turn with more speed.
With more speed.
They're already going 210 miles an hour when they're going into turn one. I honestly, if peak speed, I think we can see 215 this weekend.
Really?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I think we can see 215.
I'm excited now.
Which would be absolutely wild, but I'm really excited. You know, they have that huge sign in turn one that measures the car's speed.
The car's speed.
I'm thinking
we're
going to see 215.
They're going to break it.
They might.
They're
it might
bust
just
it
say
215?
Too freaking fast, because they're going to be absolutely hauling. I'm extremely excited.
I want to hear your predictions now.
Well, so this is going to be a new segment on the show. We're going to do a ignorantly early pick. Now, we have our own fantasy thing going on, but we make these picks after qualifying every week. By the way,
it's kind of hard to pick.
I had Logano this week. You had
Harvick.
Yep. Mitchell had the 11 car.
Yep,
that's a sketchy pick, though. And Kale had the 42.
Yep.
But so just for the show's purposes, our ignorantly early picks, before any practice, before qualifying, before the teams are even back to Charlotte right now, they don't even have the Fontana. Well, they might in the trailers. Before we know anything about the race, my pick for Fontana, it's hard to pick against the Penske guys. They've had a lot of speed this year, and it's a very, very fast track. So you might have to go with one of the big engine builders. And Logano has been good at California before, so I want to say Logano.
I'm making you pick one driver. You got
to
pick one.
Come back to me. Who are you picking?
I'm gonna pick Kyle Busch.
You know what? That was gonna be my next one.
Kyle Busch is a Fontana man.
He is
wheeling and dealing. Everything you're saying, it's faster, less downforce, more loose.
That's true.
This isn't Kyle Busch's wheelhouse.
That's a Kyle Busch kind of thing.
Logano, I was on the fence about too. Logano could be a good pick. Cause who won last year? Do you know? You remember? Johnson, maybe?
It sounds like a Johnson won in the Superman car, remember?
Okay, yep.
Late restart and beat Kevin Harvick.
Yep.
That was when I was still working at Target, so I wasn't watching.
Harvick was up there too. Okay, yeah, but I'm going to say Kyle Busch. I'll say Kyle Busch gets it done.
You know, I was going to say Kyle. I was debating between Joey Logano and Kyle Busch, and since you're taking Kyle Busch, I'm going to take Joey
Logano. Take Joey Logano? They'll battle it out.
Let's not sleep on last year's winner, though. I was going to say
Jimmy Johnson,
who's he has more wins on the West Coast swing than any other driver in NASCAR. He's from California. His first career wins at California. Fontana Auto Club. Is it Auto Club Speedway officially?
Fontana? I think they still call it Fontana. I don't think they call it Auto Club anymore. Or is it vice versa?
I don't know if it was ever Fontana. It went from California Speedway to Auto Club. All right,
time to look it up.
But either way, Jimmy Johnson got his first win there. He is also, honestly, the best defense for Jimmy Johnson is that he's Jimmy Johnson. You can't count him out anywhere. But it's, again, it's a high-speed track. Hendrick Engines has been on point this year. They swept the front row of the Daytona 500, so they have speed. But,
Auto Club 400 at the Auto Club Speedway.
Oh, okay, there you go. Yeah, I'm going to have to go with Logano.
You're Logano? Kyle Busch? Okay, yep, Kyle Busch and Logano. Let's do it.
All right. So that's pretty much
that it. That wraps it up for this week.
Well, any final words?
Final thoughts? I mean, come on. After four races, how could you not be excited to continue?
I'm so excited. It's been four great races. I'm ready for more.
Yeah.
My final thought for this week is next week, we should be in our unofficial the studio.
Oh, we're going to have some video next time?
Yeah, we might be on camera next time, not just one of these YouTube feeds. So. Yeah.
I did want to say, slight mention, the points... I really dig the stage race points stuff.
Yeah, it adds
with Kyle Larson and Lee, that is kind of crazy.
And so. Ryan Blaney up there.
I think it should be fun. It's a fun thing to look out for the first 26 races of the season. But video. Like, expect video next time.
Yeah, it's gonna be good. So I'm looking forward to the next few races. I'm looking forward to the next few shows as well. So,
okay, let's do it.
For now, this is Rocco. I'm Britt.
And this is Rocco, yeah.
Well, that's Rocco.
This is Rocco.
Yep. I'm Britt.
If you remember me, I'm Rocco. Yeah, you can check me out every Monday on Rocco's Basement, and you can see the Smoke and Flame show every Monday also.
We'll try Mondays. Let's do Mondays. It might change when we add video in there.
Ooh, maybe. We'll see. I think we can do Monday.
One day we'll be live, though.
No. Yeah, okay, maybe live. Yeah,
all right, we'll see you all next week.
Peace out.